get ready to worship. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We want to welcome all of you into the house of the Lord. I want you to worship the Lord and give God praise and thanks. As if you're watching online, we want to say welcome to our service today. And I want you to worship the Lord and give him all the glory and the praise. So we'll all stand together as we worship him. Give yourself over to him. Allow him to speak to your hearts this morning. Yield yourself over to him and let the Lord just move in your life today. Let's give him the praise and the thanks for being here today, for waking you up this morning. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. We bless your holy name, oh Lord. We thank you for the anointing this morning. We thank you, Father, for breaking every fetter, pulling out strongholds of the enemy. We liberate the atmosphere of this sanctuary this morning. We liberate every life, oh God. In the name of Jesus, touch our mind, our body, our soul, and our spirit. Let the anointing flow through our lives today, O God. Let the praises go up to you, Lord, all praises to you. Oh, Father, we enter into your courts of praise this morning, O God. We enter into time with thanksgiving this morning, Father. We thank you that we can worship and adore you today, O Lord. We thank you for life and life more abundantly. In the name of Jesus, we worship you, Lord. Let's worship the Lord. Let's give him the glory. Let's give him the honor this morning. Reach out and touch the Lord, because he's there by your side. He's there looking at you. He's there to receive the praise and the glory this morning. All you need to do is to yield yourself over to him. Forget what is around you, who is in front of you or back of you. Just worship and look up to the Lord this morning. Let's worship the Lord. Let's pour out our all to him this morning. Pour out everything that you're going through to him. All he needs is you to lay the burden on him, and he will take care of the rest. Hallelujah. Oh, Shadabayon, Tarabasandarabakudabayon, Lord. Shiandarabasikandarabasandarabayon, Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. We bless your holy name this morning, Lord. We worship and adore you. Sanctify our mind, O God, our body, our soul, and our spirit, O God. Let the anointing flow, liberate us this morning, O God. Double portion of the anointing to flow through our lives today. Oh, Holy Spirit, anoint the worshipers, O God. Anoint, O God, each and every one, O God, in the name of Jesus. Anoint your servants now as they bring forth your word this morning, O God. Let the anointing break and destroy every yoke and every plan of the enemy in Jesus' name. Every powers of darkness, of demonic forces, everything that's not of you, we come against it in the name of Jesus. And Holy Spirit, you just take full control. Spirit of our living God, just brood upon us. Let the liquid fire of God fall upon us this morning. Just worship the Lord. Give him your all this morning. Give him your all, because he wakened you up this morning to see another day. Holy Spirit, just take control. Take control, oh God. Brood upon us, oh Lord. Brood upon us this morning in the name of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus prevails. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, bless the Lord, bless the Lord. Jesus, this morning we give you praise, we give you thanks. Let your name be lifted up, oh God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. He is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise.
A mighty hand and an outstretched arm. His love endures forever. For the
give you praise, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for you're going to do it again, oh Lord, in each and every life, Lord. Hallelujah.
Your faithful. God. And today we build our trust in you, oh God. You said if we have faith as a mustard seed, you will do it for us, oh God. Nothing is impossible by the name of Jesus, because there is power in the name of Jesus. If you believe it, just reach out and touch him this morning. Open up your hearts and let it out. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, God. We thank you for your grace and your mercies upon us this morning, oh God. We thank you for bringing us into your house this morning, oh God. Lord, Father God, if you're for us, who can be against us this morning? No weapon that form against your children shall prosper. Lord, Father God, we decree and we declare this morning. Lord, Father God, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you for the Alpha. We thank you for the Omega this morning. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you for your anointing, oh God. Renew the right spirit within us, oh God. Hallelujah, Lord. You saturate in this place. You take your place, oh God. Fill the atmosphere, oh God. For the atmosphere is changing now. As we send our praises to you, oh God, we ask that our blessings come down, oh God. You just pour it out, oh God. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Whatever we're going through, we know you will solve it, oh God. No problem is big for you, oh God. Because of our faith this morning is bigger than our fears, oh God. Lord, you take full control, oh God. Take full control over our minds and over our souls, oh God. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. What a beautiful name it is. Hallelujah, Lord. You are the Word at the beginning. One with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation. Now revealed in you our prize. What a beautiful
Jesus.
other name given among men whereby we must be saved. That's the only name that we can be saved from our sins and all the things that we have done. It's only that name that can save us. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Now for just a few announcements and regular announcements. Tomorrow we have our prayer meeting for four groups from 8 to 9 p.m., 15 minutes each group. Monday also children's ministry at 6 p.m. on Zoom. And Wednesday is our prayer meeting by Pastor Kumar and our Bible, that's on Zoom, and our Bible study by Pastor David on Facebook. So remember, those two are on different location, right? One on Zoom and one on Facebook. Also, the youth meet every other Friday at 7:15 on Zoom. If you want to get your youth, your children or so, and even the children for Sunday school on Monday, you want to get them involved in the, they don't have to come to church here, right? You could log in them on the Zoom. Just let us know and we'll get all the information from you so that they can be right in the home and do Sunday school also. Now for a special announcement, I'll come back to the first one, but Youth Social is on the 10th of December at 7 p.m., right? And remember that, youths. Christmas Carol and Concert on the 19th of December at 10 a.m. and it's going to be right here. Christmas Eve Service on the 24th of December at 7 p.m. and New Year's Eve Service on the 31st of December at 10 p.m. Remember that one, don't come 10 a.m. for Christmas Eve, for New Year's Eve Service, right? It's 10 p.m. in the night. Praise the Lord. Now I come back to our Christmas Social, which is on the 4th of December at 7 p.m. and that will be right here. I know I said something last week, but we'll just cancel that for now. But we will have our social right here. And also we have a little decoration on the last Saturday of this month. And our fee is adults 12 and over, you'll be paying $30 each, right? 4 to 11 years will be $20. And 3 and under will be free. Anybody's 3? You want to make yourself 3 again? Praise the Lord. So that's our fee for, I want everybody to, you know, to be here to sign up. Don't shy away from it because we haven't had it for 2 years. For last year. So I want you to remember that. I want you to pray about it. And if you have any problem, difficulties, or anything of that sort, just talk to us and we will work things out, right? So I want you to remember that. And pray one for the other, pray for those who are not here, pray them up and pray and let the Lord open their lives. So I want you to remember all these. We'll try to get this on the board and I'll probably put it on WhatsApp on those things so you could remember, you could have a copy of what we have. Okay, the Lord bless you real good. I turn you over to our pastor, to my husband, Pastor David Jabba here. For a short word, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Shook, you have something? Oh. Hallelujah. I want to welcome all of you, each one of you, into this service. You're so wonderful. You're so beautiful. I can look from here and see that you are beautiful inside and outside. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, the world has said beauty lies in the eyes of the beholder. But I say to you, you are beautiful in the eyes of God. Amen. Say praise the Lord. Yes, you are beautiful in the eyes of God. Hallelujah. Now today we have got a lot to do. First, I want to tell you, now, that means at this moment. Now means now. Say that. Now means now. Again, now means now. Say it one more time. Now Now, faith is the assurance, the confirmation, the title deed of things we hope for. That means now. The title deed, now. The things we hope for, now. At this moment. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Being the proof of the things we do not see and the conviction of their reality. Faith perceives as real fact what is not revealed to the senses. Faith perceives as real fact what is not revealed to your senses. So, God has given us the assurance now. God says it's going to happen, not my word, but God's word. God's word is always assured. It's always certain. It always come to pass. God is not a liar. But what he says, he means. And if he says it, he will do it. When this work started, it did not stop to flop or to come under. Amen? It did not start to flop or to come under. There are times we were faced with real crisis, but we believe God in such situations at such times, and God lifts us up. Listen, I'm not telling you that there will never be moments of trial, but there will always come moments of trial, but God will always be God. The Red Sea will be divided. The water will turn to wine. The things that you see today confronting you, you will see them no more. God says so, and God has done it. Why should I doubt God? Now, we are again facing a crisis in this church. A crisis of beliefs. Let me see if God has done it one time, he can do it again. The lease of this place has increased from $2,500, guess the what, to $3,500. By $1,000 we gone up. It's a great mountain. But the mountain that you see, you have to speak. Say speak. You have to speak to it. I come before you this morning presenting to you a mountain. But the mountain that I present to you can always come down. Because we speak God's word, not man's word. We believe in Jehovah Jireh, and he can provide. How many of you do believe that? Raise your hand. I really mean it. I And if you can believe with me, this mountain that we face today will come down. So I'm presenting to you this at this moment because it came to me. I face it. I'm the one that have sleepless hours, but when I trust in God, I remember him. I remember Peter was sleeping between two of the jailers. He was to be put to death the next day, but he was sleeping. He was calmly assured that God could remove these two soldiers. And God did. God sent his angel. God send his angels. God will send you. Ha ha ha. You send me also. I say yes. I present this to you because the children of Israel was about to cross to go into their promise. Say promise. Promise. You are about to receive a promise. But 10 spies came and gave a negative report. And 2 believed God. That 10 discouraged the people and say, we are not able. But the 2 say, we are able. They were supposed to be in their promise in a matter of days. But because of a 10 men speaking evil report, they were delayed 40 years because they listened to doubters. They were delayed 40 years. And those who did not believe, they died in the wilderness and did not see the promised land. Caleb, Joshua, who believed, they were the only ones that saw the promise. Faith is learning to trust in God, even when you cannot trace him. Believe what he tells you. Believe what he tells you. His word is above everything. It is the assurance, the title deed of what God says. Is able to perform. It is a divine favor that is manifest even though it was not seen with the naked eyes. You actually say, Pastor, can you see $3,500? I can't see it. Well, I know. Deep within me, I believe and trust God to see the lease on this place. It is high time that we believe God for our own place also. Confident expectation of things open. A hope that does not have the element of doubt. Does not have the element of doubt. Hope is an absolute assurance that what God's promise will come to pass. What God promised will come to pass. I share the burden with you. I want you to believe God with me. Now, let us stand. Glory to God. Some of you are carrying your burdens too. Shalababa. There is a mountain that stands before you that is great. But say in the name of Jesus, it has come down. I don't know what your mountain is, but in the name of Jesus, Father, I present your people before you. And some of them are carrying heavy burdens of children, of home, of family, of finance. In the name of Jesus, I speak to the mountains. I speak to the problem. I speak to the cares. I say, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, be removed, be gone, in Jesus' name. I speak to the church. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, the least that may sound so great, Father, you are greater, you are mightier, you are God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And I praise you in advance for doing it to God, for ministering to the need, and for taking care of everything that there may be. The enemy that we see today, we will see them no more. Then the name of Jesus of Nazareth, $300,500, you are nothing. I said you are nothing. God is greater than that. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I praise you, O God, for supplying those needs. Even right now, I believe you in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord, you may have your seat. God is here, and the presence of God is here.
Board members, remember just after the service, we reach for 5 or 10 minutes or so. Can you collect the offering, Sister Christina?
May I see here? Please sign the list there for those who are coming to the shelter. It is there for formality. I know you will come. So I'm asking you, before you leave today, don't forget, sign at the back there. Right? Sign at the back. $20 is nothing. They're about $20. You go to a restaurant and they tell you what you have to pay. So $30, we usually go to what's the place name? Walk fee. But this place is famous also. And you will come here. You will come here for this year. Next year, when things are better, we will get up. We will get up. And, you know, it has been a regular custom to go to a restaurant. But this year, we promise you that we treat you special. Right? We treat you special. Glory to God. At this time, Pastor Kumar is coming to minister the word. And maybe he has got the word. I don't know. I didn't speak to him what he's preaching. But I know there is a word for us. A word for you. So, Pastor Kumar, come and preach your spirit out, not your soul.
Praise the Lord. Good morning, church. Thank you, Pastor David, Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You're in a good place today. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. The Lord is good. The Lord is good. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Why don't you stand on your feet this morning? Hallelujah. Lift your hands and give the Lord some praise this morning in the house. Hallelujah. The Lord has been good to you. Hallelujah. And take a 30 seconds and give him the best praise you can ever give to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords today. The Lord has done great and mighty things in your life. The Lord has worked on your behalf. You only understand what the Lord has brought you out of. And today, take one moment and give him praise this morning. For he is the God that deserves all the praise, all the glory and the honor. The enemy may after you, but I want you to know this morning, you are standing on Jesus Christ, the solid rock that is immovable, that cannot be shaken. You are standing on Jesus Christ, the firm foundation of your faith today. Hallelujah. The presence and the power of the living God is in this place. Hallelujah. The power that raised Christ from the dead. Moving dynamite. You are a powerful people, redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ, sanctified by the Holy Spirit, and you are destined for victory. It may look bleak, it may look grim, it may look doubtful, but keep your eyes on Jesus Christ, the author and finisher of your faith. Hallelujah. Name of Jesus Christ this morning, whatever circumstances you are in, whatever the storms you are in this morning, I say to you, Jesus Christ is in the boat this morning. He is in the boat. Hallelujah. The boat will not sink today, because Jesus Christ, he is the captain of the Lord of hosts this morning. Will you allow him this morning to take the stern? Wheel into his hands this morning. He is your compass. He is your GPS today. Will you give him praise this morning? You praise him this morning. Release yourself, people of God, and let the praises come forth. Honor the Lord this morning with a worship this morning. He deserves a sacrifice of praise. He asked for something that caused you something. Sacrifice of praise this morning. You have feet that you can stand on this morning. You have hands you can clap this morning. You have a voice that you can give God praise for this morning. The breath you breathe belongs to God. Would you praise him this morning? Saints of God, God has something great in store for you. But if you can look beyond the natural, if you can look beyond the circumstances, the Bible says, they that come to the Lord must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. My brothers and sisters, faith is action. Faith is not dead, but faith is active, and it has direction. It's saying, they that come to God, it is giving you direction. You come to God, not to man, not to your source, but where everything we have is a resource, but God is our source. Hallelujah. Will we trust in the name of the Lord this morning, because the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The name of the Lord is our refuge and our fortress this morning. And in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, receive today the victory, the very desires of your heart. Receive it in the name of Jesus Christ today. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Be blessed. Be fortified. Be liberated. Be free in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Give the Lord a hand of praise today. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Today, I will continue on the topic of leadership, which is so vitally important in our lives and in the church. Leaders lead from the front. How many of you ever saw a cart pulling a horse? One brother saw a cart pulling a horse. That's a wonderful experience. Praise the Lord. But in reality, the cart, the horse, pulls the cart. And in keeping with the theme from 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, says, do not let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example. Set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and purity. Here, the Apostle Paul is talking to a young pastor, and he's telling him, don't let anyone look down on you. But as a young man, he was probably asking himself, I really can't control the attitudes of people. How am I going to do this? But his father in the faith, he said, set an example for the brothers or for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. But what I love about the Apostle Paul, he did not only admonish this young minister. By the way, this also applies to all category of leaders, not only to this young pastor. And the Apostle Paul, he was a really smart man. And this is what he said to the church too. Here he addressed this pastor, this leader. But then he must address the church as well. And this is what he says in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 10 and 11. He says, when Timothy comes, see that you put him at ease among you, for he is doing the work of the Lord as I am. So let no one despise him. Help him on his way in peace, that he may return to me, for I am expecting him with the brothers.
So here the Apostle Paul, he did not only address part of the congregation, he addressed the entire congregation, leaders and believers. The golden rule, my brothers and sisters, is do unto others as you would have them do unto you. You hearing me today? And that will take care of a lot of issues. But today, my brothers and sisters, I will speak from 1 Timothy chapter 3. And here I'll address church leadership. I'll just give you a brief synopsis of this chapter. And here the Apostle Paul explained the leadership character, or the leadership and character qualities which church elders, deacons, and their wives must have. And he put special emphasis on character, family, and faithfulness. And at the end of this chapter, he concluded with a hymn summarizing our beliefs in Jesus Christ. In this entire chapter, the Apostle Paul addresses the leadership in the church. And the first segment of this chapter, he addressed the pastor. But before I go there, within our own spirit, it's unmasked in the way we live and the life decisions we make. And that is why the Apostle Paul saw personal character as a major qualification for church leadership. How a person conducts himself indicates how he manages his life and areas of responsibility. We can have charisma. Charisma is great. Charisma is excellent. But our character trumps everything. Those who desire to be leader. For the church, there can be no compromise in the area of personal integrity. And this is what the Lord Jesus said. As he was addressing the Pharisees, Jesus said to them, he said, you clean the outside of the cup and the dish, but inside you are full of greed and self-indulgence. First, clean the inside of the cup and the dish, and then the outside will be clean. Our lives, our inner lives, determine our outward behavior. Saints of God, those of you who are here, those of you that are looking here online, church leadership is very essential and it's very important. And church leadership is a noble and respectable position that requires nobility of character. And Paul called everyone to live exemplary lives as he wrote of this very high value he placed on the church and on relationship within the body of Christ. And in summing up the very first portion of this chapter, this is how I will sum it up. Leaders in the church
may have duties that can change with time and culture. The qualities that are timeless and the main standards for pastors and other leaders requires a blameless character. And Paul described the outer evidence of such character. If you recall, the Apostle Paul told Timothy to be an example in speech, in conduct, in faith, and in purity. The desire to become a pastor, the desire to lead, it's an honorable desire. And the Apostle Paul says that in chapter 3, verse 1. Here is a trustworthy saying: if anyone sets his heart on being an overseer, he desires a noble task. It's something noble to desire. But what I want to do today, I would not focus so much on the pastor, but I'll just highlight a few things that are required of the pastor. I will not go into the pastoral qualifications, but I'll list some of the duties that are required. First, that person must be able to teach. It says in Acts chapter 20, verse 28, pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseer, to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. Secondly, the pastor was able to equip. And the Bible says in Ephesians 4 and 12, to equip the saints for the ministry, for building up the body of Christ. The pastor was able to rule. 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15. Do your best to present yourselves to God as one approved, as a worker who has no need or no shame, or rightly dividing and handling the word of truth. He says the pastor must be a shepherd. 1 Peter 5 and 1, I exhort you, the elders among you, as fellow elders, and as a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker of in his glory that is going to be revealed. Dear my brothers and sisters, the pastor was able to be a shepherd. The Bible says in 1 Peter 5 and 2, shepherd the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly as God would have you, and not for shameful gain, but eagerly. The Bible says here in verse 3, not domineering over those you are in charge of, but be an example to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appear, you will receive an unfading crown of glory. My brothers and sisters, those are some of the basic requirements, duties of the pastor, my brothers and sisters. And here, my friends, I want us to look at what are the requirements of the deacons, and it's taken here from chapter 3, verse 8 to 13. It says, my brothers, in chapter 8 here, deacons likewise are to be men worthy of respect, sincere, not indulging in much wine, not pursuing dishonest gain. They must keep hold of the deep truths of the faith with a clear conscience. They must first be tested, and then if there is nothing against them, let them serve as deacons. My brothers and sisters, this morning, Paul is discussing here what sort of character and lifestyle deacons were to maintain. He did not precisely define what deacons did in their particular task of duty. This leaves lots of room
for flexibility within the body of Christ. But my brothers and sisters, the men in the book of Acts, then in Acts chapter 6, the Bible said they wait on table, they see that the widows were taken care of. But my friends, this morning, saints of God, the main issue here, however, is that God has a strong view of what kind of people he wants to present and lead the church, the type of people he wants to represent and lead the church. Those who desire to lead the church and those responsible for enlisting leaders shall follow these qualifications. And here the Apostle Paul indicates that a deacon is to be worthy of respect. He must be of a serious mind about spiritual and leadership issues. He is to have an inner character which calls for respect from the people with whom he served. It does not matter, he should be stern or inflexible or unbending, but his life should evoke admiration. The deacon is also to be sincere. Literally means not double tongue. He must be known for truthfulness. His word must be reliable. His yes must be yes, and his no must be no. Samuel Jackson says that words are the dress of our emotions. Verse 9 said, the deacon must also keep hold of the deep truths of the faith. This is a warning against allowing into leadership people who are ungrounded, who are unstable in their Christian faith, or who adhere to strange and unfounded doctrine. This practice has crept into the early churches. And that could be one of the reasons why many were hesitant to answer the call of pastorate and leadership. Verse 10, Paul underscores the importance of a leader being blameless, stating that deacons must be first tested. They must be first tested. As a young Christian, we grew up in a culture where leaders were elected by the congregation. But we're living in changing times. We're living in changing culture. And that is why the pastor and the leadership must be led by the Holy Spirit. And the church must be led by the Holy Spirit. Nothing happens. The pastor, the leadership cannot be effective outside of the presence of God. We need, the church needs the presence of God. If there is a day and time when the church needs the presence of God, is this time in which we're living in. Because there's so much deception out there. People believe lies for truth, and they exchange the truth for lies. But only the gift of discerning can discern the lies of the enemy, because the deception is so thinly recognizable. It is so thin that you cannot detect it naturally. It's only the Spirit of God that is able to discern the deception. And here, my brothers and sisters, the Apostle Paul is making a very strong point here, that those that selected or elected must first be tested. This is not a formal
or you don't have to write an examination. Because many people pass the examination, but when you put them to the test, practically, they failed it. Verse 12, it says, the deacon is able, the deacon is held to the same standard as the overseer, or the deacon is held to the same standard of the pastor. It's no two different standard. And so the leadership is expected to operate on a high standard as well as the pastor. There's no double standard. He must be the husband of one wife. Here, my brothers and sisters, Apostle Paul is saying not only that they must be the husband of one wife, but they must be able to manage their children and their household well. The Apostle Paul, he concludes this section, and he's saying, the church suffered many crises in leadership. And the leadership, they have a duty, they have a responsibility to protect the congregation from false teaching and false doctrine. You have an important responsibility. You have oversight of the people that you lead. So don't take your responsibility and your duties lightly. False teachers brought division to the church and led some away from the faith. Paul wanted to restore leadership to its rightful place and to restore the people and to restore their respect to the office in which God called them into. How many of you sense the call of God? How many of you sense the call of God? And you feel you don't have an opportunity to exercise that calling. What do you do in a circumstances like those? You find things to do. Sounds strange, but you find things to do. So there the Apostle Paul, he addresses the deacons. But from chapter 3, from verse 12, he points out the heart of a servant. Leaders, pastors, they have a shepherd's heart. But not only a shepherd's heart, they need to have the heart of a father. It's two different things. You can have a shepherd's heart. Very important. But at the same time, you must have the heart of a father. here the Apostle Paul is addressing the servant's heart. He says, if anyone wants to be first, he must be the very last. If anyone wants to be first, he must be the last. Mark chapter 9 and verse 35. And that is how the creator of this universe, the God of gods and the Lord of lords, defines greatness. That is how he defines greatness. In our natural ability, in what we see, and how the world defines greatness. The world defines greatness based on your status and your ability, your gifts and your talents, and the bottom line on your balance sheet. But the Lord defines greatness as one basically who becomes the servant of all. But there the Apostle Paul, in this entire chapter, he addresses the pastors, he addresses the deacons, and he's saying what type of heart we should have. But the Apostle Paul is very holistic in his teaching. And here he's addressing the church. How he sees the church, or how God sees the church. And this is what he says in verse 14. And verse 15. He says, although I hope to come to you soon, I am writing you these instructions so that if I may delay, you will know how people ought to conduct themselves in God's household, which is the church of the living God, the pillar of and foundation of truth. Without Christ, my brothers and sisters, the church do not exist. And we must know who we belong to and what he expects of us and align ourselves accordingly. Here the Apostle Paul is saying here, the people must know how to conduct themselves in the house of God. You see, God sets up institution. He sets up the government, one institution. The family, marriage, which is a second institution. And he sets up the church. In the day and time in which we are living in, all three of these are being under attack. In our world today, the church is seen as a place to avoid. Yet God firmly established the church, bestowing it with honor and declaring that it shall not be overwhelmed. The church shall not be overcome. The church will not go under. The enemy shall not prevail over the church. Regardless of what the church is facing, the church will rise triumphantly because the head of the church is the Lord Jesus Christ, and he is the captain of the Lord of hosts. Hallelujah. He said he will build his church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Despite of society no confidence vote, it will, the church will triumph, and the church will rise victorious in whatever the church is facing today. My brothers and sisters, the Apostle Paul described the church as God's household. I don't know how you see the church today, but here the Bible
Bible is saying, the church is God's household. The household in the first century was a bit different from what it is in modern times. Hallelujah. Not only did the ancient home consist of parents and children, it also included an extended family. It included workers and stewards, as it is a framework or a microcosm of what society is at large. And here, my brothers and sisters, the church or the household is a type or is a symbol or it's a parallel of the church. And within the household are various age groups and genders and duties and responsibility. Over this diversity was a master who kept the house in order, the stewards who bore responsibility to the master and for those in charge. The household is a picture of the church in a variety and structural way, bringing together a mixture of talents and gifts, men and women, adults and children, professionals and laborers. All of them are cared for and guided by stewards. Pastors and deacons are responsible to the master. The household is also a picture of warmth and refuge which family provides. We are to treat one another with love and respect of brothers and sisters, mothers and fathers. The church is exemplified to the world a place of acceptance, love and protection as offered by the other members and by God himself. We are members of God's household. We are members of the family of God, and we must treat each other with love, with respect, and with dignity, because we are created in the image and likeness of God, and that is why we are to treat each other with respect and dignity. Hallelujah. As Christians, we are members of the church of the living God. We are his assembly, his gathering. The emphasis is on God who is alive. This group is known as the church. It is distinctive from all other groups because the one who has called us into everlasting life is an ever-present God. This is not a club, but it is the assemblies of God. It is a gathering. It is the ecclesia where the ideas and the theology and doctrines are teached so that we can know the truth and the truth that will set us free. My brothers and sisters, the church is an institution that is living and is active. It is more than an institution. It is an organism that is alive, and anything that is alive will grow. Anything that is alive will reproduce of its kind. Everything that is alive will move. And that is what the church is. The church possesses all the characteristics of a living being. It moves, it grows, it reproduces, it has feelings. My brothers and sisters, the church is the body of Christ. Hallelujah. And the Lord is coming back for this bride. This, my brothers and sisters, the Lord is coming back for a church that is without spot or wrinkle. How are we doing today as a church? How are we treating each other? How are we doing in our relationship? How are we doing in our service? How are we doing in our duty? How are we performing our calling? My brothers and sisters, the church is the church. The church is the Lord's, and the Lord has laid on his life for the church, my brothers and sisters. Amen. Hallelujah. My time is running out. I'll just wrap this up here quickly for you. In a quick review, my brothers and sisters, church leadership is a noble and respectable position that requires nobility of character. Paul called everyone to live exemplary lives as he wrote of the value God placed on the church and in leadership. message. Many times you hear, that was a great message. That was a great word. But may I remind you, my brothers and sisters, it cannot be great if there is no application of that message to our lives. The message is not intended to make you feel good and to pump you up. The message is for application. Wonder why the churches are the way it is. Because we want to be pumped up. We want to feel emotionally raised, and our emotion and our ears tickled, and hear what we want to hear. But the Bible says, be not only hearers of the word, but be doers of the word. And then we will see the transformation take place in our lives. We wonder why we come to church and we remain one stage as infants, as babes. It's because we fail to apply the word to our lives. So I'll leave you with some application. But before I give you the application, forgive me for taking a little bit of your time. I respect your time. But here's the principle. Church leaders are meant to be models in character, family life, and relationship. There are clear guidance of how church people should live and behave. Church leaders have a greater weight of responsibility because of the influence on others. Principle. Here is application. Young people who want to serve as leaders and pastors in the church should be guided by their mission, by the church, and by strong leaders who are matured in their spiritual grace. Church leaders should adopt the standards for pastors, deacons, deaconesses, as listed in this chapter and other sections of the Bible. Married people who serve in official position in the church should have sound, growing marriage. While there's a lot of room for differences and minor points of faith, there is a particular way to conduct ourselves in the family of God, and it requires depth of character. My brothers and sisters, this morning, this is my presentation to you on church leadership. Shall we all stand this morning? Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Lift your hands all over this place today. Hallelujah. You've heard the word this morning. Hallelujah. And the Spirit of God spoken to you. Everything that was said today may not be for you, but I'm pretty sure there was something that the Lord intended for you. You're not here by chance or coincidence, but you're here by divine appointment, and the Spirit of God is speaking this morning.
You may feel unworthy. You may feel unqualified. You may feel your past is holding you back. But I'm saying to you today, the call of God is without repentance. You have messed up, but God is a God of a second and third and fourth chances. You're here this morning and the Spirit of God is speaking to you. He's not a judgmental God. He's a God of compassion and mercy. And God is able to make something beautiful out of what you think cannot be restored. There is a presence that is in this place this morning. And I believe that the Spirit of God is ministering today. Hallelujah. Father, today, I thank you for your people today. I thank you for this opportunity to speak your word to them. I pray that your word that is anointed, oh God, that the anointing from your word, oh God, will minister to the very needs of the people today in the name of Jesus Christ. I release that anointing this morning to break yokes and fetters and bondages in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray today, God, that your people will see clearly the path in which you're taking them in the name of Jesus Christ. Those that are sick today, Lord, I release that healing anointing upon them even right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Those that are seeking a breakthrough, I pray that breakthrough even right now. I command it to take place even now in the name of Jesus Christ. Those that are seeking favor, I release that favor to them in the name of Jesus Christ even right now. In the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Lord, we give you praise. We give you thanks today. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen and amen. Give the Lord a hand of praise and Father, name of Christ.
Praise the Lord. God is good. God is good. Hallelujah. Yes. Just continue to pray. Continue to pray. Hallelujah. You know, Jesus was praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. And as he was praying, he told his disciples to wait and pray. Wait and pray. Watch and pray. After hour he came to them and they were asleep. He said, again, I go yonder. You watch and pray. And they were asleep when he came back. Too many times we are born sleeping. There's a spring. Shalom. 5 minutes more of your time. 5 minutes more. Shalom. When you left your room this morning, did you think to pray? Did you think to pray? Before your feet touched the ground, did you think to pray? Shut up. I'm speaking to everybody here. I'm speaking to myself. I speak to the youth, to the youngest, to the oldest in this place. Did you think to pray? Shalabah. What is it that is troubling your life? Where can I improve as a person? When God made man, He didn't make man to rule over man. But He made man to rule over his life, over his situation, over his circumstance. And I want you to see yourself as a ruler, as a leader, and you will be promoted. You will be exalted. Shalom. Shalababa. When He made man, He said, let them have dominion, not over one another, but the birds, the sea, the land, the earth. Let them have dominion over these things. You see yourself as a person of dominion. Anything that exists unlike you upon this earth, you have to take dominion over it. Creeping things, unseen things, principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, take authority. Take leadership over these things that keep you bound. Do not allow yourself to be sold over to your circumstance and to situations that affect this earth. By the name of Jesus, remember, you with God can remove these obstacles that stand in the way. What stands before you today? What stands before you as a person, as a leader? What stands before you? Shalababa. Shalababa. What is it that keep you down? Look into your life. What thoughts are coming to my mind? Are they strongholds? They could be strongholds. Strongholds. Strongholds are coming down. Strongholds. Father, in the name of Jesus, the Lord is saying, there are strongholds within your life that need to be removed. And I'm speaking to everyone here. Everyone, not one, including myself. There are strongholds in your life that rule over your life that is not supposed to be. Shalababababababa. Strongholds of criticism. Which one? Strongholds of inferiority, strongholds of doubts, strongholds of fear. Bring them down in Jesus' name. Don't allow them to grow. Don't allow them to prosper. Don't allow them to kick over your life. Don't allow them. So you speak to them. You speak to them. You speak. speak to them in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, everything that is not of God, come down. Come down. Come down, I say, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And Jesus said, Shada Baba, Yenda Baba, Yala Baba, Yenda Baba. Strongholds. Strongholds are words within you. Strongholds, I see, they are words within you. Strongholds are things that you speak. When you speak them, they happen. They happen. They happen. Hallelujah. Father, in Jesus' name, I break every stronghold in our minds today. Every stronghold, every evil, every doubt, every fear, I say you are broken. To you in Jesus' name, I say, words, you are broken. The words of God come alive within us in Jesus' name. God bless you real good. See you again. And I tell you what, your life is important. Your life is the life of God. You have God within you. You are the brother of God. You are not the brother of the first Adam. You are the brother of the living Christ. Jesus is within you. God bless you. Real good.